Hi, I'm Professor Philip Russo. I am a healthcare researcher, and I am the director of research at Nursing and Midwifery at Monash University in Melbourne, Australia. Been doing research now in this area for 10 years or so, and most of it is focused on healthcare-associated infection and infection prevention and control. Surgical site infections are quite common in hospital settings, unfortunately. There are different types of surgical site infections and different risks, but generally speaking, when we're talking about a surgical site infection, it's either a superficial infection, which involves just the subcutaneous tissue, or it can be a deep infection, which often involves muscle and bone, or an organ-based infection, which involves the organs of the body. They occur as a result of having a surgical procedure. So you get cut open, procedure takes place, the wounds are sewed up again, and at some stage down the track, there may be some signs and symptoms of infection, such as redness and soreness and fever, and things may go on from there. Usually, superficial site infections are easier to treat because they're not deep, they're only superficial. Maybe a brief course of antibiotics and usually are treated in the community quite well. But we often don't know about them because they don't come back to hospital because it's easily treated in the community. It's a different story for deep and organ-based infections. They are quite serious, very serious, often life-threatening, and often require long courses of antimicrobial therapy, intravenous drugs, and sometimes patients have to go back to theatre to have the wound washed out and operated on again. So deep and organ-based infections increase length of stay and have significant morbidity and mortality attached to them. And it's particularly serious when we're talking about joint operations. So everybody would have known that you can have a hip replacement and a knee replacement. And if a joint, such as an artificial knee or an artificial hip, becomes infected, then that is quite serious, and that often does require having the joint removed for a long period of time, making sure the tissue around it is clean, and then trying to put another joint back in place. So it has significant costs for just not only the hospital, but also for the patients. Unfortunately, we don't have any good data on how much it costs in Australia. But if you just think about it, the increased length of stay is going to cost more, and more costs with stronger and longer antimicrobial treatments, reoperations, staffing costs, and then of course there's cost to the patient. They are in hospital for longer, they may lose work, they have some physical and mental impact of the infection, and it also impacts the patient's family. So surgical site infections present a significant but preventable cost to society. Unfortunately, we don't have any good data on Australian surgical site infections. We're one of the few countries in the world that doesn't have a national surveillance program for surgical site infections. So what we have to do is look at smaller sample sizes and what's happening in those hospitals, and then extrapolating that out to the broader Australian context. So what we believe there's probably around about 45,000 surgical site infections that occur every year in Australia. That's our best guess estimate. And from that 45,000 surgical site infections, we estimate approximately 900 people die with that surgical site infection. So it has a significant effect on the Australian population. Several years back, we undertook what we call a point prevalence survey in 19 acute large hospitals across Australia. And what we did is we went into each of those hospitals and counted how many patients had an infection, any type of infection, and whether or not it was healthcare associated. And what we found of a survey of of almost 3,000 patients, that about 10% of those had an infection, and of those infections, around about 28% of those were surgical site infections. So in Australia, they were the most common infection that we found in adults in acute care hospitals in 2017, 2018. That's the best data that we've got at the moment to get an estimate of what is happening in Australian hospitals. There's many factors that have an influence on whether or not a surgical site infection will develop. And there we have some non-modifiable factors. We can't modify these things in the patient, such as age, gender, whether or not they've had a previous infection and their immune status, and also if they have any chronic comorbidities. And then there's modifiable risk factors for patients as well that we can do something about prior to surgery. That includes patients who have diabetes, who may be obese, alcohol and tobacco use, poor nutrition status, physical fitness, and certain medications will increase risks as well. But we can modify all those to decrease the risk of infection prior to surgery. And then in the operation, some surgical procedures have a higher risk than others, what we call dirty surgery, and that's often when we're talking about surgery with the bowel and we open up the bowel contents of the bowel could spill into wounds. That's what we call dirty surgery. So that type of surgery has a higher risk of infection as opposed to what we call clean surgery, where we're operating in sterile parts of the body and there's no contamination. The other factor is that how long the surgery takes. So the longer the surgery or procedure takes, the higher the risk of a surgical site infection, because simply the longer you've got the wound open in the operating room environment. Antimicrobial prophylaxis has a big influence, and Australia is blessed because we have really good guidelines for antimicrobial prophylaxis for surgical procedures. The other factors include operating room environment, the skills of the surgeons and staff involved, and staff practices, and also how many staff are in the operating room as well. We should be trying to keep the operating room quiet and to as few people as possible. Like many things in infection control, a multimodal approach is the best way to decrease the risk of infection. So it's not just one factor. For surgical patients, we need to address the modifiable risk factors firstly. So in that case, if the patient who's about to have surgery drinks a lot of alcohol and is a smoker, then they need to stop those things. If they have poor nutrition status, then they need to build up their nutrition status, as what may be the case in elderly patients. If they're a diabetic, they need to make sure that their diabetes is well controlled. And if they're obese, they may need to lose weight prior to the surgery. So they're the things around the patient that we are able to modify. Other factors that we try and do pre-surgery is making sure that the patients have a preoperative bath in the appropriate solutions. It's really crucial that the antimicrobial prophylaxis is given at the right time prior to surgery, the right dose, and the right way. And there are really good guidelines in Australia we have about antimicrobial surgical prophylaxis. Sometimes some patients, if they're at high risk or if they're having a high-risk surgery, they may be screened to, such as having a nose swab or a groin swab to detect whether or not they may be carrying any organisms that could cause an infection. And if they're found to have those organisms, they may be required to go through a decolonization process, such as using certain soaps to clean off the microorganisms prior to surgery. Hair removal is often a practice that's undertaken. It's important to use clippers and not shave the skin prior to surgery. We also need to make sure that we're using the correct skin preparation as well. So something with chlorhexidine, gluconation, and alcohol is commonly used. During the operation, it's important to maintain normal body temperature and sugar control, what we call glycemic control, maintaining the blood glucose levels at appropriate site. And of course, there's those other parts of the operating room environment as well, which I mentioned earlier, making sure that the door is kept closed, that not many people are coming in and out of the operating room. Of course, all the instruments need to be sterile. The air needs to be appropriately filtered through HEPA filters, and traffic needs to be kept to a minimum in the operating room. So there's multiple things that can be done to prevent a surgical site infection. It's really important that patients are well informed prior to surgery and they understand all the risks that are involved. And it's not just infections that can occur after a surgery. There are other risks associated with anaesthetics and just being in a hospital generally. So it's really important that patients prior to surgery are informed of all those risks and are able to make a decision as to whether or not they want to proceed with the surgical procedure. The other part of it is they should also be informed if there are things that they can do to decrease their risk of an infection following the surgery. So those things that I mentioned to earlier, they may need to lose some weight. They may need to stop, well, they will need to stop smoking and perhaps stop drinking too much. And these are all things that can decrease the risk of surgical site infection. Not one of those things will alone prevent an infection, but we need, like I mentioned earlier, a multimodal approach to surgical site infection prevention. And if the patient is doing things to decrease their risk on their side, that does decrease the risk overall of a surgical site infection.